Good evening and welcome to another edition of Medicine in the News. I'm your host, Dr. Lee Radosh. One of the most common conditions that we see in primary care and in many offices is swelling of the legs or edema or swelling elsewhere of the arms or other parts of the body. Now typically swelling of the legs or edema is caused by trouble with the veins in the legs or leg problems in general, but it can be other issues too, some more serious. And luckily in 2010 there's much more of an understanding of the causes of this, thus we have much better treatments. And to help us wrap our heads around these concepts and some of the latest treatments for this is Dr. Eric Jaxheimer. I'm really glad that Eric's with us tonight. Eric's a vascular surgeon who is with RPS Vascular Specialists here in Reading. So he's a specialist in vascular surgery, and maybe he'll talk a minute about what that means. I really appreciate your being here on a hot summer day. Actually, if you could spend a minute, first, can you tell people, some people may not know what a vascular surgeon is or what that means.
So, Lee, thank you very much, and it's my pleasure to be here. Vascular surgery is a medical practice that deals basically with arterial and venous problems outside the chest. So the cardiac surgeons, most people know about cardiac surgery. The cardiac surgery surgeons basically take care of the arteries and veins within the chest, and pretty much outside the chest is our province. And so we deal with a lot of arterial problems, stroke prevention with removing of plaque from the arteries in the neck, patients who have aneurysms where arteries enlarge, particularly within the abdomen, to treat those. Patients who have insufficient blood flow to the legs, where we improve their blood flow to take away pain with ambulation or allow ulcers to heal. And then on the venous side, which we want to talk about tonight, the vein's job is to carry the blood flow back to the heart. So if there are significant problems with veins in the legs, that can be one cause of swelling. But there really are a whole host of other causes for leg swelling.
Okay, and we'll just also say for our audience, if you have any questions or comments about this topic, please call at 610-378-0426. Again, 610-378-0426. So if someone has edema or swelling, what are some of the symptoms they would be looking for?
Well, swelling basically is fluid that is within the tissues of the leg. It's important to note, is it one leg or is it both legs? If it's only one leg, it makes you think about more intrinsic problems with the veins in the leg, which carries the blood flow back to the heart, or also with the lymphatics, which are tiny little tubules that carry fluid out of the legs. If someone has edema involving both legs, particularly if it's painless, if it's edema that has just slowly, progressively developed, those type of patients are retaining fluid. And the reason that you see it in the legs is because the legs are the most dependent portion of the body. So for people who are sitting or people who are standing, the legs will be dependent, and the effects of gravity, that's where the fluid will accumulate.
So, and we were talking a little bit before the show that some of the causes of swelling in the legs are problems with the legs and the veins, particularly, we'll talk about in much greater detail. But can you talk a little bit, what are some of the other things people should think about if they've got trouble with swelling or edema in the legs? What are some of the other medical problems we should consider?
Well, in people who are otherwise healthy, the physiology of the venous system is important. In other words, if I were to spend all day long standing in one position, I would not be taking advantage of a pumping action that we have. For example, when we walk, our calf muscles, as we walk, the calf muscle contraction helps to pump the venous blood flow back to the heart. There's also a plexus of veins within the foot, and the same thing happens. When you compress those veins, the venous blood flow is pumped to the back to the heart. So walking is physiologically far better than simply standing. If I stand in the operating room all day long, I will have some degree of edema in my legs when I go to the locker room and change to come home.
And that's just gravity and
that is effects of gravity, right. Now, other things, if someone has an increased amount of salt intake, with salt goes fluid. And so the body will retain water to normalize the concentration of salt. So if there's a large amount of salt intake, those patients will carry more fluid, and again, it will gravitate to the most dependent portion. The physiology is also impressive. For example, when you look at a patient who's had a stroke and their one side is paralyzed and they're in a wheelchair and they're in a nursing home, and in the morning they're put in their wheelchair and they spend the whole day in the wheelchair, I mean, that basically is against good physiology, and and we get asked to see that patient with a paralyzed, swollen leg, and it's nothing more than the effects of gravity and the dependency of that extremity without any type of physiologic pumping.
And what about some of the other causes, too? Like, I guess, let's talk a little bit about heart failure, one of the most common conditions we see in this country. How would a trouble with the heart pumping cause fluid in the legs?
Well, the heart, as a pump, most people think about the heart pumping the blood flow out through the arteries, but the return of the blood flow to the heart comes through the veins. So if someone is in heart failure, the pressure of that returning fluid is quite high. And there is a gradient that develops where there's not enough venous pressure to get that blood flow back to the heart. And I guess one could think of it almost as the fluid backs up within the right side of the heart, which also can affect the organs. For example, the liver can become swollen. People can develop fluid within the abdomen called ascites, but the leg edema is key. And again, what's the tip-off to that? Well, that edema tends to be both legs. It tends to be a slowly progressive thing, unlike a patient that would wake up one day and their leg would be massively swollen. And also, it tends to be painless. There are other conditions, for example, kidney failure, where the kidneys cannot get rid of the extra fluid in the body. So there's a tremendous abundance of fluid. People, if they're weighing themselves daily, will note that their weight is going up, and that's just basically fluid retention. And again, that will show up in the legs. Liver failure, the same type of thing. Anything that really causes an accumulation of extra fluid, the legs is where it will show up.
So what I'm hearing among the causes of leg swelling is really there's not a one-size-fits-all for the cause of it. You can't just look at someone's swollen legs and say, aha, it's from X, Y, and Z. It could be a whole host of things.
And that's absolutely true. And you know, if we see a patient, there's a tremendous amount that you can learn from the questioning of the patient. Again, the onset of swelling, and actually you look at them and are they otherwise healthy? Or are there an 80-year-old patient who's had previous coronary revascularization with a history of previous congestive failure? There's a lot that you can tell about the patient when you talk with them, the symptoms, pain, no pain. And then when you look at, for example, venous disease, there are lots of tip-offs with that in terms of typical venous type of pain, which tends to be an achiness, a heaviness within the leg, previous episodes of phlebitis, deep venous thrombosis, patients who have venous disease to the point where they've developed venous stasis ulceration. So there's a lot when you look at the leg, so your physical examination can point you in a direction that provides perhaps some insight.
Great, and I think we have a caller. Good evening, and welcome to Medicine in the News.
Yes, I have a question for you. Mm-hmm. Regarding the veins and the legs, does varicose veins have any connection with swelling of the legs, or is it a cause of swelling of the legs? That's my question. I'm going to hang up and listen to the answer. Thank you.
Great. Thanks for your question. And this caller is not a plant, because we were talking about this right before the show, because there is so much overlap between the veins of the legs and the swelling that can happen if there's venous problems. And we were going to talk about that. Let's talk about that along these lines. The caller brought up a good point. What's the relation? You had mentioned that the veins bring the fluid from the bottom of the legs back into the heart. So one would imagine that if there's a problem with the veins, it may not work. What are some issues with veins that you see that can cause some of the swelling?
Well, that is a good question, and thank you for that introduction to the venous portion of this. Varicose veins, by definition, are veins, superficial veins in the leg, that have enlarged in size. And typically what happens when they enlarge, they bulge, because they're just beneath the skin surface normally. And when they're enlarged, they'll bulge to the surface. Associated with veins are valves. And every several inches down each vein in our leg are valves that allow the blood basically to flow from the foot back to the heart. When the vein distends, those valves become incompetent. And the physics behind this is very interesting, because the same pressure that you appreciate when you put your head under 3 or 4 feet of water in the swimming pool, that's the same pressure that develops if you have 2, 3, 4 feet of veins where the valves are not working. So that pressure within the venous system, particularly below the knee, can become quite significant. And because the venous pressure is high, there's going to be a movement of fluid from within the vein to the tissues adjacent to the vein, and that is a cause of edema. Now, I hasten to say that there are some patients with small varicose veins, really not much in the way of discomfort. It would be unlikely that a small varicosity would cause leg edema, but I've seen plenty of people with massive varicose veins, and in those situations, leg edema can very much go along. But again, if you've got one leg with varicosities and one leg without, it would only explain the edema on the side with the varicosities.
And if we could put up the first slide, we have a couple pictures here to show our audience. And down here, we could see these big bulging veins on the side of the skin here, which would be pretty typical or big example of varicose veins. But up here, this slide is called telangiectasias. Basically, and Dr. Jackson, are they very thin, small veins, like a millimeter in diameter?
Right. The telangiectasias are the very superficial veins actually within the skin.
Okay.
And
purplish,
some people call them spider veins, but they just look like little spider legs, and they're purplish, bluish, reddish.
They're more cosmetic in most cases as compared to, in most cases, really causing swelling. Is that
right? In the absence of significant varicosities, spider veins should really not cause edema. Now, spider veins can be seen in patients with high venous pressure because of big varicosities as well.
And then also, while we're looking at these, again, some other pictures of veins here as another example, some varicose veins, which would be, you know, fairly typical. And over here, again, pictures of that, what you were talking about, the telangiectasias. And then over here is just a picture, not to go into detail, but just really along the lines of what you were saying. This is like a cross-section of someone's leg. And up here we could see there's different muscles in one part. There's a little blue spot here and over here, which are veins. And this just really echoes what you were talking about. There's so much in the calf that it has to do with the mechanics of pumping it back. So you can imagine that if there's a problem with any of these parts, you may not have good return. I think what we're going to do is just take a very short break, and then we'll be back in just a moment to talk more about venous disease and edema of the legs.
You're watching Medicine in the News on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information about your community and other health-related stories, go to bctv.org. Medicine in the News on bctv.org is underwritten by the Reading Hospital and Medical Center. For more information on how you and your business can become a program underwriter, go to bctv.org.
Good evening and welcome back to Medicine in the News. I'm Dr. Lee Radosh. This evening we're talking about edema, swelling of the legs, and some of the venous disease or problems with the veins of the legs that can cause that. With me tonight is Dr. Eric Jaxheimer, a vascular surgeon with RPS Vascular Specialists, the local vascular surgery group here in Reading. And he's helping us understand some of the causes and treatments of edema or leg swelling. And we were just starting to talk about the relationship with veins and problems in the veins and how that can cause swelling. And if we can go to a graphic here, we have a nice picture that you brought in, Eric, and this is what the valves or the little doors in the veins look like. In the middle is sort of a schematic, and this is an actual picture. Here's the sidewall of the veins, and these are the valves, these little sort of doors that flap open and close. And can you talk a little bit about how these valves can cause problems in the veins?
The picture in the middle is an artist's rendition, but the picture on the right side is the actual image. And the valve is a tremendously interesting structure. And it's amazing when you think that of all the valves we have that they function so well most of the time. But the valve basically allows the blood to flow upward through the vein as the valve cusp just moves off to the side. The problem lies when that valve becomes incompetent. And when the valve becomes incompetent, the effects of gravity will pull the venous blood flow downward. And if the valve does not close, that pressure continues to build up and up and up. Now, patients who've had previous deep venous thrombosis where they've had a clotting within the deep veins, those valves are typically damaged or destroyed. But patients who have varicose veins where the main superficial veins have become dilated, those valves have become stretched out. And again, they don't function well in that regard either.
So basically, the valves that you were describing, they're sort of like, in their ideal function, a one-way door where the blood will go up the vein back towards the heart, and when it sort of shuts, it tries to prevent blood from coming back down the vein, But if there's too much pressure in the vein, or if the veins have been damaged from blood clots or things like that over time, then the one-way valve unfortunately becomes a two-way valve, letting blood backtrack, and that can cause a problem.
That can cause a significant problem. And in fact, in the varicose veins, that one-way direction almost becomes the one-way direction the wrong way, which is what then leads to the consideration of how to treat the varicose vein. It would be wonderful if we could simply just operate and fix the valves, but that's so far has been a challenge that's not been met. And for many, many years, the technique of treatment of varicose veins had been one of removing the abnormal vein, the abnormal superficial vein. Now, the deep veins in a normal person would carry about 80% of the blood flow to the heart. The superficial veins only about 20%, but in an abnormal situation, there really can be very minimal effective blood flow carried through an abnormal saphenous vein, which then allows us to be able to treat it either by removing it surgically or a brand new technique to close the vein using a type of laser energy or radio frequency energy.
Well, let's talk about some of these treatments. If you can put up a slide. First of all, talk a little bit about what they call the conservative treatment, sort of the basic treatments that most people know. I think most people know that you get some leg swelling, you elevate the legs, but you, from what you're saying, there's a lot of science behind that. It has mm-hmm. to do with the gravity exercise, and again, that speaks to what you were talking about, that compressing, using the mechanisms there, stockings, and treating underlying conditions. We'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. But I think a lot of people, when it comes to venous techniques for trouble veins, people may be familiar with chemical therapy or sclerotherapy, some of the newer techniques like thermal techniques and mechanical. Can you talk a little bit about each of these three, like who may be a candidate for what's called sclerotherapy, and what is that?
Well, currently sclerotherapy plays the biggest role with the very smallest veins, the spider veins, or the small varicose veins. Sclerotherapy is the technique of injecting a solution into the vein which irritates the vein wall. Basically, it causes the vein to clot off.
Okay.
And over time, in reference to the clot, that vein is destroyed. So once the clot is absorbed by the body, that vein atrophies and becomes hopefully non-visible. Hmm. Once a vein gets to be more than 5 millimeters in size, it takes such a long time for that clot to dissolve that most people would avoid using sclerotherapy for the larger varicose veins. For the larger varicose veins, one of the techniques that we really haven't talked about yet is venous ultrasound or duplex scanning. And when you think about the last 20 years in medicine, ultrasound has been a tremendous boom to diagnosing, and we can get so much more information about the anatomy of the venous system today with ultrasound, both in terms of the deep veins and the superficial veins. But with the superficial veins in particular, we can tell exactly where the problem lies. And so you can tailor your therapy to the patient with the knowledge of that, you know, you're treating the abnormal great saphenous vein, or you're treating the abnormal small saphenous vein, or you're simply treating varicosities are because of what are called perforating veins.
And these ultrasounds, as people may know, ultrasound uses sound waves, so that's without radiation or anything like that. So if someone came to you with some type of venous problem, it'd be very typical for you to get an ultrasound to get a good picture of the veins to really get a good idea what's going on in that leg.
Yeah, ultrasound is used a lot in the hospital's vascular lab and our office vascular lab. We use ultrasound for many things, but on the venous side, the patient there, where there's a potential consideration of an acute blood clot, ultrasound, that typical test is done to rule out the blood clot. When we're looking for causes of what's called venous insufficiency or the more chronic problems, we're tailoring the ultrasound to get far more anatomic information.
Okay.
And specifically the size of the veins, the valves of the veins, the function of the valves.
At these ultrasounds, can you actually see the valves opening or closing and seeing if they're actually functioning or not?
You can actually see it, and it is incredible. And you can see that the reverse flow direction within the vein. By having the patient take a deep breath and bear down in an abnormal vein, the blood flow, you can actually see it go the wrong direction.
Wow. Now, if you see that, what would be some of the treatments you said for some of the bigger veins? Sclerotherapy, in other words, just injecting a chemical to irritate the vein, won't necessarily work. What are some of the, you mentioned some of the laser techniques, and how do they work in these cases?
Well, the laser technique, which has been the most recent boom to venous surgery, is actually to use the laser or a radio frequency energy to basically destroy the vein from the inside. And so the trick is to get the laser device within the vein. And we actually use ultrasound to visualize the vein, usually at the level below the knee. And with visualization of the vein by ultrasound, we pass a little needle into the vein and then exchange wires and catheters to the point where we can then pass a longer catheter up the leg to the level of the groin where that great saphenous vein joins the deep venous system. And then after putting local anesthesia around that vein, and this is basically an office-based procedure without the need for general anesthesia, the need for a surgery center, we can anesthetize the vein, turn the laser on, withdraw the laser, and it's the laser light that generates heat. It's the heat that cooks the vein and destroys the protein in the wall and destroys that vein, thereby stopping that retrograde flow of blood.
So it's analogous to that chemical irritation, but using heat. And you can see in this picture, boy, how tiny, and this is just one of the lasers that I saw on the internet,
right.
People may have these images of huge lasers, but
right.
My goodness, like you said, these are just tiny, tiny instruments that no wonder it's becoming such a less invasive procedure. That's amazing. I believe we have a caller. Good evening, and welcome to Medicine in the News.
Hi. I have nerve damage in my leg and my foot. Would that be a reason for my leg to be swelling all the time, or would there be something else wrong?
It's a good question, and one of the things that happens in our legs and our arms, there's such a complex interplay between small arteries and nerves and veins. And would someone who has nerve damage, how would that impact the venous return? Is that possible, or is it maybe limiting motion? Is there a relation with that in your experience, or not as common?
I think if it's simply isolated nerve damage, I don't believe that would really affect the venous system, unless the nerve damage was so severe that the calf muscle and foot muscle pumping was a problem because of the inability to walk.
Okay.
But I guess the question is, associated with the nerve damage, there's a condition called reflex sympathetic dystrophy.
Very
that can have swelling associated with that as well. That would, I would say, would be the most likely intertwining of those two phenomenon.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for your call. It's a good question, and we're always finding out about some interconnections between different diseases and organ systems in the body. So you were talking about how, particularly with this laser surgery, that the idea is, again, to sort of destroy the walls of the vein so the vein over time sort of closes to prevent that problem. One thing that this reminds me of, it's very common, particularly for women who have had breast cancer surgery, that they get swelling in their arms.
Mm-hmm.
And what is the physiology behind that? What are some of the causes of that, and how can that be helped?
There are two main reasons why a woman with breast cancer would be subject to arm swelling. And that type of swelling is called lymphedema.
Mm-hmm.
The implication is that it's the problem with the lymphatics. Lymph nodes, which reside in multiple areas in the body, but in particularly the axilla, they're sampled or they're removed in women who have breast cancer surgery. So the lymphatics can be affected with that. And then the secondary thing that occurs with radiation therapy is radiation therapy can cause some scarring of the lymphatics as well. So the two main reasons are either the interruption of the lymphatics with the surgical biopsying of the lymph nodes, or the addition of the radiation therapy fibrosis.
So again, the idea that not all swelling is from the same causes. Sometimes veins and venous disease may play a role, sometimes general medical conditions, but also that lymphatic system, that system that helps bring back that fluid, could be damaged and for a number of reasons, it sounds like.
That's right.
In our last few moments, or last moment or two, there's this, is it a myth or a truth that sort of a hot summer day, people say, oh, my legs get swollen? If that happens, why would that happen in just a moment?
I think there's a truth to that. The physiology in the heat is people probably drink more, they perspire more, they vasodilate more.
Okay.
I think with the vasodilatation, which is when arteries and veins can enlarge, edema can occur with that.
Okay.
Usually it's not, that would be a very, very mild edema.
Okay. Probably not as much as people think it is related to the heat, but it sounds maybe the salt intake, like you were saying, or other factors. I think we are unfortunately just about out of time, and I want to first and foremost thank my guest, Dr. Eric Jaxheimer. Again, he's a vascular surgeon with RPS Vascular Specialist here in Reading, and I very much appreciate your being here, and of course all the excellent teaching you do to us physicians at the hospital and our residents and great care of our patients. This has been Medicine in the News, and of course remember bctv.org is a new website that we have that really needs you to send in stories and photos, articles for the web. If you go to bctv.org and click on Be a Citizen Journalist, and we can get your stories out there, and you can tell us what's going on in Berks County for everyone in Berks County to see. So thanks again, and have a good evening.